Okay, take like four. Hello, hello. My name is Emma. I am a recent Eckerd College graduate with a Bachelor of Science in Marine Science with a focus in biology, and I also have a minor in psychology. I am 22 and I am passionate about jellyfish. So that's kind of what this series is going to be about, I think. I hope it lasts a while. Kind of awkward, not really sure how this is going to go. Probably going to be a little bumpy, but you know, I just kind of want to say my piece, put my two cents out there about what I think is cool, what I think is kind of weird, why I'm passionate about the things I'm passionate about. And also, I'm just incredibly bored in this unsure time of the world right now and trying to find a job in the field. So I was like, this is a good, productive use of my time to, you know, talk about some cool science shit, you know? Okay, well, I guess I'll start. I have a little bit of an outline. So I'm gonna first start off with how I got into marine science. So I was a sophomore in high school and I had this teacher named Mr. Berenson, who obviously kind of saw that I was not like most other kids in my high school. I went to high school in Missouri, and you know, there's obviously not an ocean anywhere easily accessible. So I had this passion for the ocean. I had a passion for science, whereas most people were trying to go the business route, but had to take, you know, the science classes to get their high school diploma. And so I was just kind of talking to him, and then he talked about how there was this really cool program at the World Aquarium in downtown St. Louis, and they were doing this cool thing where you could go and you could take classes there, and then you could volunteer at the aquarium, and then that would all pay for a trip to go down to Florida to work with the Florida State University Coastal Marine Lab and collect some biodiversity data for the aquarium. So I was like, oh, this sounds right up my alley. I got into the program, and then yeah, I just kind of volunteered at the aquarium, you know, saw all the cool things that we had there, but I knew that, you know, going out in the field would obviously be a lot better, I guess. That's a terrible way of putting it. But essentially, how I got into marine science and how I got so passionate was there were these tide pools, so we went out at night, and then there were, like, things glowing in the sand in, like, these little tide pools, and I was like, that's so strange. Like, we're just, like, out, like, you know, in this super shallow water, like, I don't understand what could be glowing. And then, you know, I went closer to the thing and I saw that it was just this blob. And then when you picked up the blob, you could run your finger over it. And like the bioluminescence, it just kind of glowed as you ran your finger over it. And I was like, that's so cool. And then I learned that it was a tinafore. And I had no idea what a tinafore was. I, like, had known what jellyfish were. And the way that Mr. Berenson tried to explain it to me was that, oh, like, these are similar to jellyfish, but they're not true jellyfish. And I was like, I don't really understand what that means. So I'm going to break it down for you. This is how I learned what the difference between a tinafore and a jellyfish was. And this is how I realized that the ocean was sick. The ocean was super cool. Like, there was just so many things. It was so diverse. I had, like, never seen anything like it before, because I had obviously been on vacations to Florida and been, you know, to the ocean before, but I had never really had that great of an appreciation for the organisms within the ocean. I was like, oh yeah, let's just sit on the beach and, you know, get tan and whatever. And then this trip really changed my life, honestly. And then I eventually applied to Eckerd and blah, blah, blah. But, you know, that's a pointless story, I guess. So, a tinafore. I don't know if any of you know what a tinafore is, but there's probably a picture of it on the screen, hopefully. So, basically, they're very similar to cnidarians. They, you know, have the gelatinous body. They don't really have a central nervous system. They don't have, you know, what we call a quote-unquote brain. They're like 97% water, and basically all their movements are just, you know, up to the ocean currents and, you know, other things carrying them. So the difference between actinophores and true jellyfish, such as like moon jellyfish or Portuguese man-o-wars or box jellyfish, you know, all of the jellyfish that you think of when you hear the word jellyfish. The main difference is they're in different phyla. So what a phyla is, it's just a group of organisms that has a unique body plan. And phylas are usually determined by the morphology, so what the organism actually looks like on the outside, their genetics, so what's going on the inside, and then also like the evolutionary history is how we kind of base the entire animal tree of life. So you've probably heard of a phylogenetic tree, or sometimes it's called a cladogram. That's just basically a diagram showing how all of these different animals are related. And then it obviously goes out to like bigger and bigger, to where there's, you know, the eukaryotic organisms, and then there's the bacteria, and the archaea. So there's, you know, this is kind of how we group all of these animals that we know. So basically, ctenophores and cnidarians are in two completely different phyla. You can probably guess that they're called phylum ctenophora and phylum cnidaria. Pretty fitting, I would assume. But cnidarians also include things such as like corals and anemones. I'm going to delve a little bit deeper into, you know, ctenophores just in general. Like what their body plans look like, why they're so cool. I think that's a safe leeway point, I suppose. Looking at this animal tree of life, or the invert kind of side of the things, because you can see at the top there they have the chordates, so that's all of our vertebrates, all of the mammals, the reptiles, so on and so forth. But all the things to the left, so you can see the cnidarians and the ctenophores. And then there's also like, you know, different kinds of worms. There's mollusks, like, you know, snails and such. So those are all invertebrates, so they lack a spine, essentially. And you can see that ctenophores kind of branch off of the same lineage as cnidarians, so they are like very, very similar. I mean, if you take a look at, you know, a ctenophore and a cnidarian, you put them next to each other to the untrained eye, they would probably both seem like jellyfish, right? But there are actually some key differences between the two. I'm going to talk a little bit about what those main differences are, and like if you were trying to identify one out in the field, how you could probably do that just by looking at it. But then they also obviously have a lot of internal structures that are vastly different than that of most quote-unquote true jellyfish. So there are only about 150 described species of ctenophores, and then in comparison there's about 11,000 species of cnidarians. You know, that also includes the corals and the anemones and whatnot, but you can see that there's a greater amount of jellyfish than there are ctenophores, I guess you could say. So on the outside, you can see that ctenophores, they have what's called biradial symmetry. So that means that you could cut them in half and it would be equal on both sides. Whereas jellyfish, so like we can take like a moon jelly, for example, like you guys have probably seen those at the beach and whatnot. Those have radial symmetry. Definition of it, it's the arrangement of body parts around a central axis. And so you can probably see this from their arrangement of tentacles and sensory receptors, around the base of the jellyfish. And so then they have, you know, their mouths on the bottom, and then they have the aboral side, so the opposite of the mouth. So jellyfish and all cnidarians have radial symmetry, whereas, like I just said, ctenophores have biradial symmetry. So they're not as symmetrical when looking down at them from the top. They're more, you know, kind of half and half, like another cool thing about ctenophores, so ctenophora basically means comb bearing, C-O-M-B, comb, I don't know if that translated well. So comb bearing just means that they have these rows of bioluminescent combs on each side of their body. So they have two rows on each half of their body, essentially. So they have four in total. And these combs are ciliated. So that means that they kind of vibrate really, really fast, and that's how the tenophore move. So the tenophores are multiciliated, so they have a ton of little vibrating parts that allow them to move throughout the water column. And then the cnidarians only have one cilium, where they don't really use it that much. They mainly use the pulsating and the contractions to move throughout the water column. And then the tenophores, they do have true muscles, whereas cnidarians have myoepithelial cells, which are not quote unquote true muscles. They're just kind of cells that act as muscles for them. But the tenophores do not really use their muscles that much. Like, they don't play a significant role, in their lives, and whatnot, but it is important to mention that they have true muscles and cnidarians do not. What else? These things are just so cool. I guess I can talk about a little bit the kind of standard issue tenophore, I guess you could say. So probably the species that you may have seen the most is called Monopsis lighti, the sea walnut. It's in Atlantic coastal waters, but it's also been an invasive species in Europe and Asia. So probably one of the most notable stories about comb jellies being an invasive species, and kind of harming a fishery or a body of water or something, was in the Black Sea in the 80s. So the Black Sea at this time, and I believe still today, is home to a lot of like larvae of pelagic fish. So I know that they were farming a lot of anchovies at that time in the Black Sea. And so previously there had only been one species of comb jelly in there, the small sea gooseberry, if you're interested. I'm going to butcher the scientific name, so may not say that. But that comb jelly was in there. Like, it was doing fine. It wasn't eating too many of the larvae. It wasn't eating too little. Like, it was maintaining its aquatic ecosystem. But then, of course, as most invasive species are introduced, it was by humans. I think it was like a ship or something that had some stowaway passengers of some sea walnuts or the Monopsis lightis. And so they bred like crazy in the Black Sea. They just kind of went ham, and then it turns out that there were just like a immense and immaculate amount of this Monopsis lighti in there. And they were destroying the fishery, because they were going in and they were just completely destroying all of the larvae and the eggs of the anchovies. And so then obviously the anchovies were not able to, you know, grow up and then be harvested to put on your pizza or whatever people do with anchovies. And so people were trying to figure out, like, oh shit, what do we do about this now? Like, now we have this influx of these small little gelatinous things that are suddenly destroying our entire farm. And so then they decided, or they found out that there was one species of predatory comb jellies. So, you know, obviously other things such as like vertebrates and like birds and fish will eat the comb jellies, but it's not a main source of their diet. So they're not, you know, going out to look for these comb jellies and to, you know, feed on them as their main food source. But there is another species of jellyfish that can that actively hunts these Monopsis lightis. They're called Boroi orvata, and so they have a little bit of a different body plan than these sea walnuts do, and they can open their mouth and just engulf the entire Monopsis lighti, but they don't necessarily feed on, you know, the larvae of eggs or, like, planktonic things. Like, they just, their main food source is other comb jellies. So once scientists and the fisheries people figured that out, then they put in, like, I think, like, the story has it, they put in like 10 for these like 1,000 Monopsis lydies, and then they came back a little bit later and the Barrowies had completely eaten all of the Monopsis lydie, and then the Black Sea went back to, you know, its duties of becoming a fishery for cod and anchovies and all these different things. So that is a little telling on like how jellyfish can kind of, you know, ruin some ecosystems, I guess. I don't know. I mean, jellyfish are awesome and I think they're beautiful, but I will admit that they're definitely not the best for most industries and for most ecosystems, because I mean, they can thrive in pretty extreme conditions. Like, jellyfish are found all around the world. Like, they can live in super cold water, they can live in super warm water, and so they kind of, I don't want to use the word proliferate again. They thrive, I guess you could say. They thrive in any sort of environment. And so they are caught a lot as bycatch. I remember like seeing these stories in like off the coast of Japan, and like the fishermen cool species now. Yes, all that happened in the Black Sea, but I mean, that can happen with a lot of different organisms, you know, just kind of disrupting the normal habits of a certain ecosystem. That'll happen with any invasive species, which is unfortunate, and people definitely need to be more careful about introducing new species into places where they are not native to. But I recently found out that the comb jelly that I saw in Florida, back to the beginning of this little podcast, I guess, that was a Monopsis lydie. And so I think that this is probably my favorite species, just because, you know, it holds kind of a story and a deep place in my heart for, you know, getting me introduced into the wondrous world of marine science. But yeah, I hope that I continue this podcast. I'm just kind of rambling at this point. I think I kind of said all of my piece about, you know, the basics of tenophores and their difference to jellyfish. I feel like I'm doing like a presentation at school, but this is really just for fun. Like, I can talk about whatever the hell I want, you know. I am the leader of this podcast, I guess. Yeah, so I guess that's it. Thanks for listening. You know, smash that subscribe button, hit that like, and hopefully I will talk to you soon. Thanks for listening. That was pretty cool of you to make it all the way to the end of this. Yeah. Okay, bye.